Good morning, student. Good morning to all of you. Today we shall see 7th lesson, packing. Actually wise, this is an extract from the very good, humorous, interesting novel written by J.K. Jerome. This novel was prescribed for the 10th standard, and this extract is the fourth part of the novel, and the title of this lesson is packing. Before we go ahead, let me ask you, a few questions that will introduce our lesson, packing. The first question is, do you like going on trip? Of course, your answer is very clear. Every child, every student like to go outside. They are jealous, they are enthusiastic, they are interested, they are very excited to go on trip. And that's why the question is this. Do you like going on trip? What kind of trip do you enjoy most? Second question. How do you feel about having to pack for a trip? Third question. Have you ever discovered on a trip that you have forgotten to pack a few things you very much want, need, or that you can't find them easily? Does this make you angry, annoyed, panic, or does it make you laugh at yourself? Now, if you answer the answer of this all question, then you may have the idea about this lesson. Boys, I am going to read the first paragraph to you, and after first reading, I will try to focus on the new word which you think. Come on. Now, there are three characters in this chapter. Jimmy, okay, George, and Harris. Jimmy is writer himself. George and Harris are his very close friend. See, they are going on a trip. Actually, it is a novel, as I have said to you. These are middle-aged persons. These are middle-aged men. They are tired of their day-to-day life. So they want to go on the sea for 10 days. And that's why they are packing all the necessities. They are packing all the things which they will need during their trip, during their life on the sea. So, see here, all these characters are very humorous. All these characters are very simple, from simple life. Jimmy, the writer, George, Harris. Like everyone, Jimmy is very boastful man. He gives airs to himself. ही बोस्टफुली सेज दैट ही इज नंबर वन इन पैकिंग. व्हाइल ऑल दिस कैरेक्टर्स आर वेरी लाइट एंड वेरी सिंपल. नाउ जिमी स्टार्क, व्हाट डिड ही से? सी एन, आई सेड आई वुड पैक. आई मीन सी एन राइटर जे कोरम, जिमी इन शॉर्ट. I said I would pack. I rather pride myself on my packing. Packing is one of those many things that I feel I know more about than any other person living. This is hyperbolic statement. Means Jimmy hears to himself. Jimmy took pride in himself. Jimmy was proud of himself that he was number one. He was, no other people could pack the thing as he could. It means that Jimmy was number one person who could easily pack everything. So this is a simple quality of man. Every man used to boast, every man used to feel proud of himself. It surprises me, see in the bracket, it surprises me myself sometime how many such thing there are. Means there are lot of thing. Jimmy said that he was expert in all these things. So don't you think that he is boasting? Don't you think that he is hyperbolic? Don't you think that he is making hyperbolic statement? He said that he thought that he was expert, he was tycoon, he was veteran in lot of things. I impressed the fact upon George and Harris and told them that they had better leave the whole matter entirely to me. They fell into the suggestion. They fell into the suggestion with a readiness that had something uncanny. The meaning of these two words means fell into and uncanny is given on the right side. George spread himself over easy chair and Harry's cock. Harry's cock. That had something uncanny about it. George spread himself over the chair and Harris cocked his leg on the table. Now, boys, there is no as difficult word as we expect. Only one word is there, and out of them, fell into is written in the corner. Uncanny is written into the corner, and pride myself on is also written in the corner. Now let me read this passage to you again, and then I will ask you question by writing the question on the blackboard. I said I would pack. I rather pride myself on my packing. Packing is one of those many things that I feel I know more about than any other person's living. It thinks there are. I impressed the fact upon George and Harris and told them that they had better leave the whole matter entirely to me. They fell into suggestion with a readiness that had something uncanny, strange about it. George spread himself over the easy chair and Harris cocked his leg on the table. My questions are like this. First, how did Jimmy feel or how and what did Jimmy feel about packing? First question. Second question. How did Jimmy impress George and Harish? Next question. Why did George and Harish accept what Jimmy told? Last, what did George and Harris do? So, boys, these are the questions to which you have to answer. I will read this paragraph to you, and you will find the answer of all these questions written on the blackboard. I said I would pack. I rather pride myself on my packing. Packing is one of those many things that I feel I know more about than any other person living. It surprises me myself sometimes how many such things there are. I impressed the fact upon George and Harris and told them that they had better leave the whole matter entirely to me. They fell into the suggestion with a readiness that had something uncanny about it. George spread himself over the easy chair and Harris cocked his leg on the table. Now, I would like to ask any of you to read the passage. You read the passage and find out the answer of this all question written on the blackboard. Okay, here, what is the summary of this passage? Jimmy was proud of his skill packing, and he also boasted that he was tycoon, he was expert, he was stalwart in many things like that. And he told his friend George and Harris to leave all the matter to him about packing. Now, as soon as the writer told his friend that they should leave each and everything about packing to him, they became ready. Because these people were very lazy, they used to be never ready to do anything. But as they were told by Jimmy, they become ready, the writer became doubtful. And now, as soon as they accepted the challenge given to them by the writer, they reacted. How did they react? George spread himself over the easy chair and Harry spread his leg on the table. So, this is this in the first paragraph. Now, let me go ahead to the second paragraph. See, I will read the second paragraph to you. This was hardly what I intended. What I had meant, of course, was I should boss the job, and that Harish and George should potter about under my direction, I pushing them aside every now and then. often, every now and then. This was hardly what I intended. What I had mean, of course, was that I should boss the job and that Harish and George should potter about under my direction, guidance. I put them aside every now and then with, "Oh, you here, let me do it. There you are, simple enough." Really teaching them, as you might say, they are taking it in the way they did irritate me. There is nothing does irritate me more than seeing other people sitting along doing nothing when I am working. Now, except this one, there is no any difficult word. I will read this passage to you and then I will ask you question to which you have to answer. This was hardly what I intended. What I had meant, of course, was that I should boss the job and that Harish and George should potter about under my direction, pushing them aside every now and then with, "Oh, you here, let me do it. There you are, simple enough." Really teaching them, as we might say, they're taking it in the way they did irritated me. There is nothing does irritate me more than seeing other people sitting about doing nothing when I am working. So what was writer's intention? What was Jimmy's intention? First. Second, what did irritate? What thing did irritate Jimmy? Okay, see here. I will read this passage to you again. The answer will be clear to you. This was hardly what I intended. What I had meant, of course, was that I should boss the job. He wanted to boss the job. He wanted to be a director. He wanted to be a guide. He wanted to be a monitor. He wanted to be a facilitator. I should boss the job and that Harish and George should potter about here under my direction. I pushing them aside every now and then with, "Oh, you here, let me do it. There you are." Simple thought. Simple enough. Really teaching them, as you might say, they are taking it in a way they did irritated me. There is nothing does irritate me more than seeing other people sitting about doing nothing when I am working. Now he used to get irritated if someone look at him and he is working hard. At that time he used to be irritated. If someone watches him, if someone observes Jimmy working, while he is working, that thing irritates him. Okay, let me go toward the third paragraph. I lived with a man, now he remembered. This novel is story in the story, or this novel is nostalgic. The writer, Jimmy, always remembers the past incident. From this incident, he remembered his past. Which incident? That what was his intention? While he said that he would look after the packing, it does mean that he wanted to do the role of boss. He thought that George and Harry should work under his guidance. That was his intention actually. He did not want to work under their supervision. He wanted to guide George and Harry. Hey, do this. Hey, do that. In his guidance, in his direction, in his instruction, under his instruction, he thought that his friend should work. But the thing had changed. The table turned on him. And he used to get irritated when someone looked at him working. And now he remembered one incident about a person with whom he was living. I lived with a man once who used to make me mad that way. He would loll on the sofa and watch me doing things by the door together. He said it did him real good to look on at me, messing about. Now I am not like that. I can't sit still and see another man slaving and working. I want to get up and superintend and walk round with my hand in my pocket. I tell him what to do. It is my energetic nature. I can't help. Boys, some new words are there. First, I lived with a man who used to make me mad that way. Lol. Means sit lazily. Lol, to sit or to take rest lazily. Watch me doing thing by the hour together. He said it did real, he did him real good to look on and messing about. This is friend. Messing about means waste time. Messing about now. I am not like that. I can't sit still and see another man slaving. Working hard. Slaving, I want to get up and superintend and walk around with my hand in my pocket and tell him what to do. It is my energetic nature. I can't help me. So he remembered his friend and see here what usually what happened whenever Jimmy used to work, his friend used to look at him and that irritated him a lot. What he used to do? He used to take rest easily. He used to loll on the sofa and watched Jimmy doing thing by the hours together. And what did he say? He said that he was spending his time in that way. And his friend was spending time in that way while Jimmy was working hard. And he used to say Jimmy that he wanted to supervise his work. And while he used to supervise Jimmy's work, he put his hand in his pocket and he did the supervision. That was his part of nature. So this thing irritated him. I will read this passage to you and then again I ask the question, writing on the blackboard. I lived with a man once who used to make me mad that way. He would loll on sofa and watch me doing thing by the hours or for a long time. He said it did him real good to look on at me, messing about, passing time. Now I am not like that. I can't sit still and see another. So actually what happened? This man was very bogus. Writer's friend was very bogus. He used to say that he never wastes time. And he did not like to watch anybody else while the other person is working and working hard. just he want to put his hand in his pocket and used to do the supervision. So this is the complex nature of writer's friend. I live with a man who used to make me mad that way. He would loll on the sofa and watch me doing thing by the hours together. He said it did him real good to look on at me messing about. Now I am not like that. I can't sit still and see another man slaving and working. I want to get up and superintend and walk round with my hand in my pocket. I tell him what to do. It is my energetic nature. I can't help. Now, here the question on this passage are, what story did Jimmy remember about his friend? What story did Jimmy recall about his friend? Second question is, what is your impression about Jimmy's friend? If you answer this question, you will get thorough understanding of this passage. I would like to ask any of you to read this third paragraph. So I will bring my idea home. And now fourth paragraph. However, I did say nothing but started the packing. It seemed wrong. Now we have to come back to the lesson again. This is a nostalgic memory. He remembered about his old friend, how he was time doing the supervision, working nothing, but saying that he was not like that man who only waste time. Actually, his friend was very bogus man. He used to watch people working hard and did nothing. And this is the human nature. Everyone used to admire himself by saying that he is all right, he is okay. No other people are as good as him. He is the only superman in the world. So this is a writer's friend. Now come back to the original story in the fourth paragraph, and it goes like this. However, I did not say anything but started the packing. It seemed a longer job than I had thought it was going to be, but I got the bag finished at last and I sat on it and strapped it. "Aren't you going to put the boot in?" said Harris, and I looked round and found I had forgotten them. That is just like Harris. He couldn't have said a word until I got the back shirt and strapped, of course. And George laughed, one of those irritating, senseless laughs of his. They do make me so wild. So here actually the packing started. Let me see any difficult word. I will read this passage to you again, finding out the new word to you. However, I did not say anything but started packing. It seemed a longer job than I had thought it was going to be, but I got the bag finished at last and sat on it and strapped it. "Aren't you going to put the boot in?" said Harris, and I looked round and found I had forgotten them. That is just like Harris. He couldn't have said a word until I got the back shirt and strap, of course. And George laughed, one of those irritating, senseless laughs of his. They do make me so wild. Now, what actually happened? You see that there is no any new word. Let me explain you to actually what happened. Now, everything was packed. And when everything was packed, George or Harris asked him whether he had kept the boot in the bag or not. Actually, Harris would have or could have told him earlier, but deliberately he saw that Jimmy was forgetting to pack the boot in the bag, and when Jimmy closed the bag, then he asked whether he had kept his boot in or not. And when he said to Jimmy that whether Jimmy had kept the boot in the bag, and George was there, he was lopping, and his lopping made the writer very wild. So let me ask you a question like this here. What question did Harris ask Jimmy about his boots? Second, what is your imprint about Harish and George nature? Okay, answer this question. I will read this passage to you again. However, I did say nothing but started the packing. It seemed a longer job than I had thought it was going to be, but I got the bag finished at last and sat on it and strapped it. "Aren't you going to put the boot in?" said Harris, and I looked round and found that I had forgotten boot. That is just like Harris. He couldn't have said a word until I got the bag shut and trapped, of course. And George laughed, one of those irritating, senseless laugh of his. They do make me so wild. Now, boys, I may ask you, somebody else, to read this fourth passage so you can, in a better way, understand it. Here we stop today. The remaining portion of the lesson we will continue in the next period. Thank you.